Hey, it's Dr. Amanda with Straightsmile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and today we're going to do yet another video on CRCO shifts. If you haven't watched my video, my live video, where it's actually me showing you how to capture a CRCO shift in CR, watch that video first. To access that video, go to my YouTube channel, Straight Smile Solutions. It has a green banner. Once you're there, tabs on the top to get all the way to the right till you find the little magnifying glass in the top right-hand corner and put in the keyword shift. And it should come up, or all my videos on shifts should come up. But look for the one that looks like me in an orange shirt, a red shirt, doing a demo. Watch that one first. Okay, so I'm assuming you've watched that video before I move on to this video. This is going to be a more advanced version of that video. So I had someone ask me today, well, you know, how do you know from static images if there might potentially be a CRCO shift? And anytime I see a patient that is class three, a little red flag goes off in my head, especially kids in mixed dentition, for sure. That's going to be a big red flag if I see two different things. And this photo pretty much captures these two different things. Number one, if I see what is a unilateral crossbite, okay, which I've done other videos on unilateral crossbites, or you can just look up crossbite or unilateral in the keywords. And that's a pretty rare and mythical thing. A unilateral crossbite or a full unilateral crossbite is very, very, very rare, okay? Usually it's associated with a shift, a CRCO shift. So to me, I look at that and I'm like, now I'm not talking about a dental unilateral crossbite. I'm talking about a functional or a true unilateral crossbite, like here, okay? The other thing that I'm looking at is the midline, okay? So you can see the midline is here and here. So anytime I see a case with unilateral crossbite, especially in mixed dentition, midline off, especially if it's lower midline off, okay, I'm gonna look at the midline with the face. And if the facial midline is on-ish and it's the lower that's off, and then I need to like basically, I need to basically do be an animation in my head, okay? I'm picturing the eyes are here, the nose is here, we're right here. That's the, this is on with the nose, this is on with the inner pupillary canthus. You know, if I drop a line between the eyes, run it down through the nose, and sometimes noses can be crooked because they get broken or whatever, so I don't fully go by the nose. But, you know, gotta make sense. This should be quasi on. If this is on and this is off, let's pretend that this patient is swinging their jaw over, okay? Just to try to find an easier way to bite, to find an easier home because there's a premature interference. If they swing their jaw this way, okay, and get this midline on, what will happen to our crossbite? It will, our so-called crossbite, it will improve. So most likely this patient, if I had to guess, probably the issue is that we have some peg laterals, which doesn't help, right? So because of the peg laterals, these teeth kind of came backwards. If these teeth were the proper size, these teeth probably would be more forwards. This is all my hypothesis, okay? I don't even know this patient. This is just a static image and what my mind is thinking. The midlines are on with the upper jaw in the center of the upper midline. That's great, wonderful, okay? These teeth are probably retroclined. So if I took a cephalometric x-ray, I'd probably see that these teeth are retroclined. That's another thing. Factor in, not only factoring in the unilateral crossbite, the lower midline off, take the ceph x-ray or a CBCT slice, three things, and see if these teeth are retroclined. Because that's also a sign of a shift. If these teeth are retroclined, they're getting pushed back by these teeth in the shift, okay? And then these teeth are most likely proclined, not always. And if you don't know how to do that, your eye needs to be trained for that. You can watch all of our cephalometric videos. We even have a cephalometric playlist on our homepage. You should definitely watch those. If we swing this jaw over, and that's not a good word, and line this up, this would improve, midlines would be on, probably even this patient, if I had to envision this patient's face, the lower jaw would be off, so it would swing over. So he probably would have some asymmetry because of this shift. And if he keeps doing this, if he keeps sliding forward every day, 20, you know, as much as possible during the day, well, he very well might grow asymmetrically. So there's a point sometimes where there's no return, where there's damage been done, because constantly stretching and compensating asymmetrically can cause growth to happen asymmetrically. But yes, most likely if this child is still growing or is within 1 or 2 years of puberty, even if it's past puberty but not too far past, you know, a boy maybe 13, 14, 15, maybe even 16, a girl maybe 11, 12, 13, maybe even 14, probably can fix this. Because this upper jaw is probably narrow, we need to do some skeletal expansion. No, it's not a unilateral crossbite. It's a bilateral crossbite with a functional shift. Okay? Like I said, if they swing this over, got this midline lined up with this midline, you would see it would be end on here and end on here. The upper jaw is probably vaulted, and that's the reason for that. So hopefully that helps you. Things to look at to know if it's a functional shift or a true underbite. And as you seat the jaw, the lower jaw back, it'll probably go to edge. So you, after you do the expansion and some 2x4 or some braces on the top to get some better torque and jump this bite, everything will probably work out just fine. All right, thanks.